You are about to hear Spiritual Centers in Man by Manly P. Hall, narrated by John Riddle. Copyright 2018, BN Publishing. Online at bnpublishing.com.
Preface. We regard growth as a spiritual process, but the phenomenon of unfoldment is actually a revelation of the release of the spirit potential with which all creatures have been endowed. Evolution is actually a kind of ideation or an expansion of consciousness through bodies. Jacob Boehme, the German mystic, describes the soul as a tree with its roots in the heart and its branches extending through all the regions of space. The fruit of this tree is for the healing of the nations, and the shade which it provides is consolation and protection for those who are weary of worldliness. The sacred institutions of both Eastern and Western nations have taught the science of human regeneration. They have revealed the paths that lead to liberation from mental, emotional, and physical suffering. In this essay, I have attempted to show that growth is a pleasant journey, and that those who keep the laws of living place themselves in the keeping of these laws. Some follow along a devotional path. Others are led to peace through philosophy, and still others by a scientific kind of alchemy involving a transmutation of character. The victory of the soul over circumstances through physiological changes is discussed in the pages that follow. Chapter 1. Spiritual Centers in Man. The question is asked, what must I do to unfold the divine powers latent within myself? While it is not possible to give a direct answer to this question, we may cast some light on the subject by defining the fundamental principles upon which the mystery schools of all ages were established as institutions of philosophic, ethical, and religious culture. The schools of the mysteries are composed of illumined men and women who have been accepted into the company of the immortals. To reach this exalted position requires an almost inconceivable amount of preparatory labor, for if man would associate with these advanced types of humanity, he must raise himself to their level. Realizing that nothing is more dangerous than the indiscriminate circulation of occult secrets, the mysteries establish their schools for the purpose of concealing rather than revealing knowledge. They were the original and sole custodians of all the divine arts and sciences, the secret keys to which they revealed only to those whom they considered qualified to receive them. Inasmuch as man's power increases with his knowledge, the secrets of nature's finer forces cannot be revealed to him until he has passed through these mysteries, which test him as to his motive and demand certain standards of moral and philosophic excellence. Before the candidate is in a position to begin his studies in occult philosophy, which, if successfully completed, will result in discipleship and final admission into the mysteries, he must first lay the groundwork by familiarizing himself with certain systems of ethics and gain at least reasonable proficiency in several material arts and sciences. 1. The candidate must realize the value of education. While the ignorant person may be capable of spiritual growth, the fact remains that man's ethical progress is seriously retarded through ignorance of the material arts and sciences. Not realizing the great value of discipline, many students of the occult sciences ridicule modern educational systems, which excel because they discipline the mind. Learning how to study is a prerequisite to effective studying. Before it is possible to think, it is necessary to train the mind in reason, continuity, and logic, the essentials of thought. In the last analysis, all the so-called material arts and sciences are reflection of the secret wisdom. A man with an understanding of mathematics cannot help but know more of the divine plan than one without. Plagothoros demanded proficiency in music, mathematics, and astronomy of all candidates seeking admission to his school. Before a candidate can honestly seek admission to the Temple of Wisdom, he must prepare his offerings and bring them to the temple. The only possible offering which he can make is himself, and this offering is acceptable only when it is usable for the dissemination of wisdom. The more nearly perfect that vehicle is, the greater its usefulness. If able to speak a dozen languages, he has a decided asset. If skilled in chemistry, gifted in oratory, clear in thought, he has valuable talents which can be quickly turned to the service of mankind. If the candidate, regardless of his sincerity, presents himself at the door of the temple, ignorant and untrained, it is first necessary to equip him for his work. This preparatory training requires years. A person willing to consecrate himself unselfishly to the service of God, the first requisite for entrance into the temple, should certainly be willing first to educate himself by learning what the material world has to teach. He must never seek for the masters of wisdom until he has something of real value to offer them, for usefulness is to a great measure limited by intelligence. The candidate must understand the importance of continuity. The curse of the modern world is its inability to finish the enterprises which it begins. As a child starts several things but completes none of them, so the child mind in man vacillates from one activity to another. Failure to achieve is the result of scattering the power of the mind over too great an area of endeavor. Man can cultivate no quality more essential to his spiritual well-being than that of finishing what he begins. Success can never be achieved in the material world without at least a reasonable development of the power of continuity. In matters pertaining to occultism, the same is true. A person who studies several lines of philosophy may call himself broad-minded, but if he carries none of these lines to a successful culmination, he is, in reality, scatterbrained. Again and again, such a person turns off and tries a new road, when just a few more steps upon the old one would have brought him within sight of achievement. 3. The candidate must recognize his debt to society. If, in his zeal to unfold his spiritual nature, he neglects those daily labors which have been assigned to him in the material world, he can never hope to attain true spirituality. Each individual born into the physical world has obligations which, if not assumed by him, must be carried by others. Among the Hindus, for example, the debt which the Brahman owes to the race that produces him is very keenly felt. This debt is not paid until a son is born to him, and has lavished upon it the parental regard and care which he previously received from his parents. Woe to those who neglect their fellow creatures to serve their God! In this world it is necessary first to earn the right to leisure time, which is essential fair personal improvement. The chief reason why people are always confronted by problems is that they are ever seeking to evade problems. So many say, life is just one difficulty after another, when, in reality, it is the same difficulty presenting itself again and again because it is not mastered. The candidate is urged to face and settle each problem of his life. In this way, perplexities are eliminated and more leisure is available for ethical progress. The prosaic duties of daily life are the elements out of which character is built, and those unable to cope with them are as useless in things spiritual as they are in things material. Occult development is an exceedingly slow process. The results of the time and energy expended are often imperceptible. This brings discouragement. The candidate gives up the struggle, considering the task before him a hopeless one. Discouragement is one of the temptations placed in the way of the candidate by the mysteries. Fear in spiritual matters, he who can be discouraged is not worthy of encouragement. It is by means of discouragement that...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.